Okay, Zahir and Abid, you're there, right?
Yeah, Sandeep.
Okay, so yesterday we talked about confidence intervals and chi-square distribution and binomial approximation, all these things, right? So is everyone clear with this, all these things? How chi-square works, confidence interval for chi-square, which is this one. How we are getting all these things, where to use it, all these things.
Yeah, Sandeep.
Okay. So with this, I will close this confidence interval topic. Let's go into something called test of hypothesis. Actually, whatever confidence intervals you know is more than enough for anyone in the market. So whatever you know is more than even the statistics background guys. So let me create another notebook. Test of hypothesis. So what is test of hypothesis? So like I said earlier, so your inferential statistics is having two branches. One is confidence interval. And the other is test of hypothesis.
Confidence interval or the estimation?
Both are same actually. We are estimating okay. Based on the confidence interval. Yeah, let me write that itself. Estimation and test of hypothesis. So estimation is done through confidence interval. Okay. So estimation is done for mu, p naught, which is the population proportion, and the last one is the variance. Sigma square. And mu we did using t test and z test. One is normal distribution, another is the t distribution. This we are using z test. And here we used chi-square. So this is the, in short, this is what we have done in estimation. The entire confidence intervals and all those things. Okay, now the test of hypothesis. So let me describe on high level what we are going to do. But we'll go in detail each of this. So in test of hypothesis, we have again three different branches. One is one sample test, when you have only one sample and you want to test something. Two sample tests and more than two sample tests. So what we are going to do is we are going to describe about one sample, but not much on two sample, because in general, we need only one part of the two sample test, not all of them. And more than two sample we'll describe. This is needed. So what we'll do in one sample test, again, we'll test for mu, p naught, and sigma. Again, the same thing. Here, for two sample test, all we need is the sigma square. We do not need p naught and mu tests. I can tell those things, But the thing is, for two sample test, generally the sigma square test is more important. If we have time, anytime if we have time, we can take up the mu and p naughts. And more than two sample test, again, this is also generally people will not go. This anyway, people will not go any more than sigma square. Variance test is more than enough for, I mean, no one will use mu and p naught for this. That is the reason why even for two sample, I am thinking of telling only the sigma square, because you will get confused unnecessarily. It's better you learn whatever you are, whatever you need. So anything that is more than two samples, that is called ANOVA. Just introducing the terms, but I'll describe in detail in future. Okay, is that fine? So what is this one sample, two sample? I'll describe later. Just saying, just opening up some of the terminology, nothing else.
So Sandeep, just quick question. So ANOVA means greater than two sample, or is it in addition to sigma square you're saying you need ANOVA?
ANOVA is done only for sigma square.
Oh.
Okay, for two sample test, for greater than two samples, I mean more than two samples, for doing a variance test, you use ANOVA. Actually, ANOVA is nothing but analysis of variance.
Okay.
So it is a variance test. Okay, ANOVA is going to be the future. Once we describe ANOVA, we are going to use it multiple times, even in machine learning, regression, everywhere. In fact, ANOVA is the reason for describing this entire statistics, inferential statistics. It is that powerful. Okay, I'm setting up, in a way, I'm setting up all my ground towards ANOVA. Okay, I need these Z tests and chi square tests. It's not like they are going away, but this is going to be the baseline for entire machine learning. So I'm in a way setting up all the ground required for ANOVA. Okay, it is that important. So just giving you caution, don't miss that ANOVA class anytime. Okay, so that is what we are going to do for test of hypothesis. Estimation, I think you're clear, right? Zahir and Abid, you're clear, right?
Yes, Sandeep.
Yeah.
Yes, Sandeep.
One second, I don't know why it refreshed. By the way, Microsoft released some patch on Office 365. So I was afraid our class will be in soup, but hopefully it was working fine. So what is test of hypothesis?
Sandeep, one second. Sandeep.
Yeah.
My screen disappeared. Remember, I'm still connected.
Abid, are you able to see?
Yeah, I can see the screen, Sandeep.
Yeah, Zahir, I think you have to re-log in.
Okay, give me one second.
Yeah.
Okay,
you're back.
Yeah.
Okay. So, what is this test of hypothesis and all these things? Let's see. I don't know why it is changing the thickness always. Okay, test of hypothesis. So what is the test of hypothesis? What is a hypothesis and all those things? Let's take an example. Actually, let's take a small role play. Okay, the role is like this. Let's take Abid as a criminal. And let's take myself as a judge. And let's take Zaheer as a cop. Okay, let's say Abid has performed some crime, let's say bank robbery. And Zaheer is the cop and he is collecting the evidence. This is very important because he has to collect the evidence before he can present it to the judge. Right? So, and it could be, there could be two cases, right? Abid could be a robber or Abid could be framed. He could be an innocent person but framed by someone. So, either he is guilty or innocent. There are both the possibilities. So, let's do the role play. It is one of the important things that we'll have to do before understanding the test of hypothesis. So, Zaheer and Abid, I think you have to open your mics.
Yeah, Sandeep.
Zaheer, you are there?
Yeah.
Yeah, Zaheer, you are the cop and you have to collect the evidence. Okay? So, for collecting the evidence, before collecting the evidence, will you think Abid is... So, this is a very important question actually. I'll use this answer later. But for now, before collecting the evidence, now you are just assigned this... case file is handed over to you, but before collecting the evidence, will you think Abid is a criminal or he is a good person?
Man, I'll be objective and it's a possible suspect because when you're collecting evidence, one is the physical evidence that you collect and the second is
don't forget about all those things because you just handed over the case file.
Okay.
Will you start your investigation thinking that he is a criminal or thinking that he is an innocent person? Thinking that he is an innocent, will you ever collect evidence? See, you have to suspect him, then only you can collect the evidence, right? If you don't suspect anything, which evidence you are going to collect? So, for example, he did a crime at 10 o'clock. Okay? 10 o'clock at Times Square. Okay? Now, if you think that he is innocent, you will collect evidence based on the 10 o'clock. You'll try to find out is he at some other place at 10 o'clock.
No, that's what I was trying to say. When you say innocent or guilty, that is the pronouncement. So, as a suspect, you will tend to collect evidence, his whereabouts, his phone records.
Yeah, but your whereabouts and all those things, you'll try to find out based on his guiltiness, not the innocence, right? Otherwise, there is no case. Why would you take up the case at all? You'll say he's innocent, right? See, for example,
I understand,
right? If you don't believe that he is innocent, how do you take up the case? You should believe that he is guilty. First of all,
what you're trying to say is you are suspecting him to be guilty.
First you have to suspect. That's what I'm saying. So when you are collecting evidence, you will collect that he is guilty, and then I mean you will assume that he is guilty, then only collect the evidence.
Yeah, I get it. I get what you mean.
For example, if there is a machinery and you don't suspect it is a problem, it is having problem, do you test it for problems? No. If you don't agree that it doesn't have any problem, there is no problem. There is no testing of all the machinery.
Exactly.
Right. So similar way, you don't believe that he is innocent. You believe that he is guilty only. Okay, that is the first thing. So this is very important question. That's why I was asking specifically. So now, how do you collect the evidence? You can ask questions to Abid. So he did a bank robbery. And what kind of questions you will ask? You can directly ask him.
So Abid, where were you at 10 o'clock last night?
Yeah, I was in Edison, New Jersey.
So do you have an alibi that you can vouch for you?
What?
Alibi means, I mean, evidence or someone who can support you.
Yeah, I don't have.
Okay. Where did you go in Times Square? Oh, sorry, where did you say you were?
In Edison, New Jersey.
Okay. Edison, New Jersey. Do you have any other evidence that you were in Edison, New Jersey?
Yeah, I came out to buy some stuff in Edison grocery store.
Okay. Can you tell me which store, what time exactly you went there?
Yeah, I went there at, 8 p.m. and the store name is Sabji Mandi.
You can also ask about any of the evidences you have, right? That is another thing. Like any CCTV camera footage.
Yes.
So, anyway, you can ask any questions that you may have.
Yeah. So, how long were you in the grocery store?
Yeah, I was about half an hour in that store, and after half an hour, I bought some grocery and I came out of store.
So, around 10 p.m., where were you?
Yeah, I was in my room.
So, you left around 8:30. So, the next question is about the CCTV from that place. And you have to travel from Edison to the place in Times Square. We have to estimate whether, of course, this is the back to you, Sandeep. So around the bank robbery, which is in Times Square, you have to look at all CCTV cameras, what cars.
Sorry, actually your voice is breaking.
No, Sandeep. So in the process, we want to check Abid's evidence, his testimony, his statement, and I'm going to look around where exactly he was, what time did he leave, which car did he live in, the CCTV footage of the grocery store.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, the phone information that might come by.
So ultimately, you have to establish. So what your role is? Establish.
Time, place.
Establish his guilty.
Yeah.
That is the minimum thing. I mean, time and place is fine. There may be 100 people who are there at that time. But all the things you need to do is you need to frame some hypothesis saying if he is at Times Square at 10 o'clock, 10 a.m., let's say, then he might be guilty. This is not confirmed, right?
Yeah.
Again, this is a bank robbery, right? If there is any fingerprints, again, he might be guilty. I mean, fingerprints, bank, there will be hundreds of people who will be visiting the bank daily. There might be his fingerprints somewhere. Again, he might be guilty, not he is guilty, right?
Yeah.
So what you're doing is you are making some hypothesis. This is your hypothesis. If he is at 10 o'clock.
Okay.
if he is there at 10 o'clock, if he has some fingerprints. All these are kind of hypothesis, right?
Yeah.
So every time what you do, you frame some hypothesis, you'll test it. If that works, your confidence level is slowly, slowly increasing.
Yeah.
Okay. Next time what you do, maybe you'll ask him, where are you at that time? And you can establish, let's say Abid said, Abid anyway, he said, I'm at the grocery store. In the grocery store, let's say at that time, his CCD footage is not there. So again, there might be chances because he is lying. There might be chances that he is a guilty person. So what you're doing every time, you are framing some hypothesis and then testing that hypothesis. Okay, you are framing some hypothesis that, okay, if he is not there in, he said he is there in the store, but you frame the hypothesis that he is not at the store and then test it. Okay, if you believe that he is at the store, then you don't look at the CCTV footage, right? You just believe it. That's it.
Yeah.
But most of the times what happens, as a cop, you don't believe in him. Even if he says, I am at the store, even if he is really at that store, you don't believe him. You just go and observe the footage, then only you believe.
Yeah.
Okay, your hypothesis is always like you don't believe, at least in this case, right? You don't believe what he is saying.
That's true.
So that is what is the hypothesis testing. So you do some hypothesis, test if it is real, if the hypothesis is working or not, it is really working or it is a wrong hypothesis, then take some decision. So test of hypothesis is nothing but decision making. So finally, your decision is he guilty or not?
Yeah.
But to make the decision, you have to use some hypothesis, and that hypothesis could establish yourself, I mean, could establish the evidence, I mean, you try to collect the evidence and you can establish either the hypothesis is correct or hypothesis is wrong. Okay?
That's right.
Yeah. So this is going to be a little bit, actually this is a little bit a tricky subject. But to make it easy, I gave this role play so that I can build on these things. Okay. So in test of hypothesis, what you do is you always select some hypothesis, test it against your established evidence, and then say if this hypothesis is correct or not. Okay. So in this case, every time there is something called alternative hypothesis, H1, which is alternative hypothesis. H0 is null hypothesis. These are the only two hypotheses that you'll be getting. So let's translate into what we know of the role play, from the role play. Now H0 is, by the way, let's start with H1. I'll tell you why we should always start with H1 later. But H1 is what you want to test against. So in the case of role play, what do you want to test? You want to test that Abid is guilty. If Abid is not guilty, you don't want to test anything. So whatever you want to test against, that is what is going to be H1. You should follow this convention. You should always start with frame the alternate hypothesis, then frame the null hypothesis. People do the reverse also, but I found this to be very useful. The reason is, what do you want to test? First, if you write here, then the reverse of it is going to be the null hypothesis. Otherwise, you'll get confused. This is one topic where if you don't follow the instructions, you'll lose track easily. Okay? Instead of saying not guilty, I'll say innocent. For example, let's say if you write this alternative hypothesis, which is H1, as Abid is innocent, will you do the test? Will you collect all the evidence and will you present it to the court? No. You don't present anything to the court if you assume that Abid is innocent. You just collect the evidence only when he is guilty to prove that he is guilty. So that is the thing that is very important. So whenever you are framing the alternate hypothesis, just think about why do you want to collect the evidence, first of all. So in all the cases, whenever you see a null hypothesis, you will never collect evidence for the null hypothesis. That is the trick that you want to play to frame this null hypothesis and alternate hypothesis, because many people got really confused about this alternate and null hypothesis. But if they followed this kind of structure where alternate hypothesis is only about collecting the evidence to prove that it is correct, to prove that Abid is guilty. If you want to collect that kind of evidence, then it is going to be an alternate hypothesis. And the reverse of it, once you frame the alternate hypothesis, the exact reverse of it will become H0, which is null hypothesis. So is this fine, Abid and Zahir?
I got one question.
Yeah.
So cop will start interrogating about the case by assuming alternate hypothesis, right? If he won't find proper evidences, it will gonna become null hypothesis. That's what you are saying, right?
So what he is going to do? He's going to collect evidence for your guiltiness. Are you really the robber or not? That is what he is going to test.
Yeah, if he find proper evidence, then so he will gonna.
Yeah.
He will be confident that I am guilty. So if you don't find any proper evidence that to prove me as guilty, so it will become null hypothesis, right?
Yes. So okay. Instead of saying it will become null hypothesis or it will become alternate hypothesis, the proper way to define this is there are only two options to this. First option is accept, or instead of saying accept, actually reject H0. Okay, when I say reject H0, this is rejected. This means that this is accepted. This is the terminology that people use. Okay, instead of saying accept H1, accept H0, like that, we always define our decision. So two options for decisions. Let me write that. For making a decision. One is reject H0. When I say reject H0, it is accepting H1, which is Abid is guilty. The other one is accept H0. This is my terminology. Actually, this should be, because I felt this is easier to describe to everyone. Accept H1, reject H. Accept H0, reject H0. Always your decision whenever you are saying, say about the null hypothesis, not about the alternate hypothesis. This is the convention people use. Okay, there is no logic there. You can also say reject H1 and accept H1. But the problem is the convention is not that. people in the statistics background, they only talk about H naught. Okay. Now there are two options: either reject H naught or accept H naught. But accept H naught is not actually the right terminology. The right terminology is fail to reject. Fail to reject H naught. The thing is, there is an alpha fifer. I'll talk about that later. But these are the only two options you can make. So if Avid is guilty, I will say reject H naught. Instead of saying accept H1, I'll say reject H naught.
Accept H1 or H naught, Sandeep?
Both are H naughts.
Okay, okay.
All your decisions are on H naught. H naught is your null hypothesis.
Okay.
Only make your decision based on your null hypothesis.
Okay.
Relative to the null hypothesis, you make the decision. That's it. Either say you can reject the H naught or say that it is accepted. But in reality, I mean, the actual terminology for accept H naught is fail to reject. The thing is, I wanted to reject this H naught. That's what is the purpose, right? I want to make him accept. I want to, as a cop, I want to tell that he is guilty, which means I want to reject this H naught. That is why I am doing all this test. I want to reject the H naught. This is what I wanted, but I failed to reject. As a cop, I failed to I failed to establish that you are guilty. Or as a lawyer, I failed to establish that Abid is guilty. So that's why they say fail to reject instead of saying accept. Is that fine? This terminology and all?
Yeah, got it, Sandeep.
Very good. Yeah. Okay, this is easy subject. Unfortunately, people made it complicated. So let's take another example. Let's take an example where you are a customer of Coke. And Coke is supposed to have, in US, is it 8 ounce? Is it correct? Is a bottle?
It's like 16 ounce, 32 ounce.
The Coke bottle, it will have 16 ounce.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's take 16 ounce, which is 32 and all. So you bought you are a customer of Coke and you regularly buy, daily you buy some Coke bottle and you will drink it. Okay. Assume that. And you found that recently there is a lesser quantity of Coke that you are getting daily because you are regular customer, you can notice it very quickly than others. So you thought, okay, this Coke is not giving 16 ounce, they are giving only 12 ounce, and then saying in the packing they are saying it is 16 ounce, but actually it is less than 16 ounce. So you're thinking that it is definitely around 12 ounce. So what you want to establish is, so Abid, you can tell, what do you want to establish then? So you are not getting 16 ounce. So I am writing H naught and H1. First, anyway, tell your H1. H1 is what you want to test, right? You are a customer. You are a customer of Coke. Okay. Now you want to establish that they are doing something wrong. And what, according to you, what is the wrong?
I mean, what is the wrong in the sense? They always offer me 16 ounce, but unfortunately, I find out that they are offering me 12 ounce.
Yes. So let's talk about, or let me tell about this one. Okay. This is the first one, right? So let's frame this one. Let me frame this one myself so that, you can frame the remaining ones. So there are multiple views in this test of hypothesis. So I am giving the customer view, because you are a Coke customer and you are going to take the Coke. You're going to test based on the view that you are a customer. And customer is at loss when your Coke, the amount of Coke you are getting is less than 16 ounces in this case. So what we can test according to statistics, statistically, if I want to write this H1 and H0, earlier I didn't write statistically, right? Now, if you want to do it statistically, you can do it like this. So your H1, on average, you should get 16 ounces. Let's say Abid purchased 100 bottles, Coke bottles. On average, at least it should be 16 ounces. If it is less than 16 ounces, then he is going to file a case. So his test of hypothesis is actually mu less than 16 ounces. He doesn't file a case, or he doesn't even collect the evidence if H1 is greater than 16 or equal to 16. Only if it is less than, mu is less than, on average you're getting a Coke less than 16 ounces, only then you're going to file the case or you want to collect the evidence. Okay, that's why always start with the alternate hypothesis. Otherwise, you will get confused. The thing is, if you try with H1 and think that, okay, what is his pain point, all those things, you might end up putting this in H1, which is like you're collecting evidence on wrong things. Sometimes your decision, most of the times your decision will go wrong because of this. Always do like this only. Start with H1. Find out why you are collecting the evidence. Only then the reverse of it is going to be the H0. Now, Abid is going to collect the evidence only when the average value, on average, you're getting Coke less than 16 ounces. Now, what is the reverse of it? It is greater than or equal to 16. Is that fine? Abid and Zahid?
Yeah, Sandeep.
Zahid, you are fine?
Yeah.
Okay. So now the same Coke bottles.
One glass.
Yeah, tell me.
So here, when I was initially framing it, H1 mu less than 16, I understood. That is your hypothesis. H0, I was thinking it is equal to 16 ounces. Right? I was going by either it is 16 ounces or less than 16 ounces. Why am I interested in more than 16 ounces?
You are not interested. That's why it is H0. You are getting it.
No.
Null hypothesis is what you are not interested. Equals is fine. Okay.
Exactly. Do
you want to collect evidence when mu equal to 16? No. Do you want to collect if mu is greater than 16? No. Again, if you are getting more Coke, you don't care. So both the cases I am keeping there.
Okay.
Okay. But if you see any books, actually in books, always your H0 will be like this, but don't get to this because it will be confusing.
Okay.
The better way is anything reverse of this is H0, because your decision will never change. Actually, you're testing for this one. Your H0 will be like this only. In books, it will be written like that, but don't get confused. This is the best way to find out H0 and H1, believe me.
Right.
Okay. Now, the same Coke bottles, I can do, let's say, as a manufacturer, what I want to do. There will be, see, the same hypothesis can be different for, the same test of hypothesis can be different for different players, manufacturer. So, for example, earlier, Because Zahir, Zahir is a cop and he wanted to establish Abid is guilty. He said that alternate hypothesis is going to be Abid is guilty. But if it is a reverse way, if Abid wanted to prove himself as an innocent, he doesn't want to prove himself as guilty, obviously. But he wants innocent person. So to prove that, he will also collect his own evidence. So everyone will have his own point what he wanted to establish. Okay, so the manufacturer might want to establish something. Okay, so let's say the customer Abid is the customer, and Abid is going to prove that the Coke company, they are giving only less than 16 ounces. But there could be other case also. The manufacturer wants to put his case in the court for a defense. He wanted to defend himself for saying that I am giving good amount of Coke. That is one case. Or other cases, the manufacturer doesn't want to spend much. The manufacturer, because your machinery is not going to be outputting always the same 16 ounce. I think we already saw in even Six Sigma, there is a 1.5 sigma shift because of these kind of errors. Now what do you manufacturer want to do? He doesn't want to see that your he's spending more amount of money by filling more Coke, right? Are you getting Abid and Zahir? So can you frame the alternative hypothesis and null hypothesis here? See, ultimately manufacturer wants to see that. Let's take the same case. Customer filed a case and manufacturer wants to defend it. Now what does manufacturer wants to defend? He wants to say that he is more, he is giving more.
So the hypothesis from a manufacturer perspective, at least an alternative will be that I'm filling it correctly, right?
So it will be like this, right? He will say, I am producing more, I am giving more. He won't say, I am giving less, right?
Yes, Sandeep.
He would try to defend that, I am giving more. The other way what you can think of is, if the manufacturer is producing more, he wanted to test that, am I producing more, so that he'll know if he is spending more on manufacturing. That's what it is required. So there are two different cases. Let's assume the court, the case on the case filed by customer itself. He wanted to prove that he is producing more. Again, the reverse will be, exact reverse will be the H naught. Generally, equal sign don't put on the H1. Generally, put it on the H naught itself. That is also a convention. Okay?
I don't understand. So,
you don't understand? So, what you didn't understand? So, let's say you're the manufacturer. And you're every day you're producing, I mean, you're the manufacturer and someone filed a case on you.
Right.
Okay, you want to prove that I'm giving more, but you are saying less.
But I'm giving less. Is that what you're saying?
No. See, whether you're giving less or whether you're giving more is not the problem. The problem is, what is the case that you want to file on the in the court?
Okay. So then okay.
This guy is going to say that. This guy is always going to say that you are producing less, and you are going to say I am producing more. Now it is up to the court to decide, right? You have to find out the evidence. What we are doing is we are only filing the hypothesis. This is what I am doing. This is what I am doing. But is it really happening? That we have to collect the evidence and find out.
So in the case, I would say either it is 16 or more, right? Isn't it?
Yeah, that's what I am saying. That's why I said, in general, don't put equals in the null alternate hypothesis, because that is not the convention for whatever reasons. Okay. Never put equals in the H1. It has to go into the H0 only. This, okay, that you have to observe always. See, if whether it is 16 or more, in general, you want to say that I am producing more. See, for example, there is a football match between, let's say, Germany and some other country, Italy or somewhere, okay? And Germany is a better player, and they lost. What they want to establish at their hometown, home ground, I mean, or their home country, they want to establish that we played well, but still we lost. Yeah. I mean, losing is not a problem, but they want to establish that they are good players. They tried well. They don't want to establish that they are not playing well, right? So that's why it will be always whatever you want to establish. But in general, as I said, don't keep the equals here. Okay, don't keep the equals here. There is a logic for this, but I don't want to tell all those things. It will be more confusing. Okay, but yeah. In general, always go with the equal sign only in the H0.
Okay.
Not even in general, always. Okay. So let's see the engineer's view. The same case. Now the engineer, his point is, why is it exceeding or getting less? It has to be very close to mu, right? From engineer's perspective, what he wants to test? He wants to test if the mu is not equal to 16 or not. Because whether it is greater than 16 or less than 16, from engineer's perspective, he is a failure. Okay? So he has to exactly produce the same quantity, right quantity, every time in every bottle. Or at least on average, he has to get it correct. So that's why engineer's perspective is that he has to adjust his machinery if the mu is not equal to 16. But if mu equal to 16, there is no problem. If mu equal to 16, there is no problem. Only if mu not equal to 16, only then he has to test it. Is that fine?
Yeah, got it, Sandeep. Engineers, in the sense, the guy who test that machine, right?
Engineer is the one who maintains that machine or okay. Develops or whatever. He is okay. The person who manages that entire machinery. Okay?
Okay.
That guy, he doesn't want either 15 or 17 also.
So Sandeep, this one doesn't fit the bill of what you're trying to establish, right?
Why?
Customer mu is less than 16 because the customer is trying to establish he is getting less than 16 ounces.
Now here also he has to establish that his machinery is not working well, then only he has to go and fix it, right?
Based on what evidence? Based on the case?
See, I'm not talking about the evidence, right? I'm talking about what is my hypothesis. Then evidence comes in. First, I have to establish my what is my case, why I have to gather some data. Then I will file a case. Okay, this guy, he thinks that he mu is less than 16. That's why he filed a case. Okay, this guy thinks that his mu is greater than 16. That's why he went and said, he went and defended his case. Otherwise, he cannot defend a case. If he thinks that mu is less than 16, he won't even go to the court. He'll settle outside. He'll go to the consumer and say, you're right, take this money and don't talk.
Hmm.
Okay. Only if he believes that he is going to give more, only then he is going to test. And this guy, only if he believes that his machinery is not working, either it is more less than 16 or greater than 16, only in those cases he is going to go and test his machinery. Otherwise, he is not going to test.
Okay,
the question is, when are you going to collect the evidence? If you are clear about when you are going to collect the evidence, then you are clear about the H1. H0 is just a reverse of it, like I said.
Okay?
Right. So, this is the basis for all the machine learning and all those things. So, you should be very clear about it. And many people, even though they claim that they know machine learning, they don't know this, unfortunately. But this is what you need. Okay. So I think this is a logical break right now. So let's take until 7:05.
Okay.
Okay. We'll come back at 7:05. Okay. Hi guys, everyone back?
Yes, Sandeep.
Yeah, Abid, you're back?
Yes, yeah, Sandeep.
Cool. Yeah. So you got this concept, Zahir? I think you had some problems in understanding this.
Yes. Yeah, I mean, I understood from when I went from customer view, I understood very clearly.
Oh, okay. This one you didn't understand still?
No, this one I got it. I had a little difficulty looking at the engineer's view because from engineer's perspective...
Engineer want to fine-tune, right? Forget about this case. He is not in this case. Only these two people are in the case. But from engineer's point of view, his point is, why is it exceeding or... why is it not exactly 16?
I was thinking about your earlier explanation that suspecting something that you're thinking it's guilty. Right? So, from an engineer's perspective, he'll be thinking it is working fine. Right? So that's how I was thinking.
Engineer's perspective, there is nothing called guilty or something, right?
Yeah.
It is only customer is guilty or the manufacturer is guilty. Either he is giving less or he is saying it is more.
No.
I mean, he's saying it is less, or he's not giving it properly, something like that.
Yeah.
Either this guy is lying or this guy is lying. From engineer's point of view, he is out of this case, right?
True.
His point is why it is not accurate.
Okay.
So that's how it is. Let's take another example and solve. At least try to find out this H1 and H0. So let's take an example. I think this time you should be able to answer. So that let's see. So let's say I am a support engineer. And I solve generally 10 tickets per day. But don't worry about 10 tickets. Don't worry about it. Let's say I'm a support engineer. And I am kept in performance improvement plan. I already talked about this kind of issue somewhere else. Just a day before, but that's fine. I'm giving a different perspective about it. Performance improvement plan. I think Zahir might know, but since Abid is just a fresher, he might not know. So performance improvement plan is like in any of the office setting, if one of the engineer doesn't work well, he will be put in performance improvement plan, in which case he might be given additional trainings or additional support or something, so that he will improve his performance. Even after the performance improvement plan, let's say he is not performing well, then he will be laid off the company. So he'll not be part of the company anymore. So let's say there is a support engineer, and that support engineer is just put into some performance improvement plan. And the idea is that this support engineer is not resolving tickets quickly. And he is supposed to resolve at least 15 tickets per day. 15 tickets per day he is supposed to resolve. Now, let's say I am the support engineer and Zahir is my manager. Let's say. So, what is my view and what is let's say, instead of saying Sandeep's view, let's say engineer's view. First, let's say manager's view. That is better. Manager's view. And there is another view, which is engineer's view. There is only two views here. So, yeah, can someone frame this null hypothesis and alternate? Abid, can you do that? So on average, I am supposed to complete 15 tickets. So what is your manager's view? What is the alternate hypothesis for him? Abhid, you're there?
Yeah, can you hear me, Sandeep?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, in the manager's view, a null hypothesis will become like, you know, if you are solving 15 tickets or more per day,
Wait, wait. Don't talk about null hypothesis before talking about the alternative. I already told you.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, so if always start with alternate hypothesis.
Yeah, sure. So if you are not performing 15 tickets per day, he will gonna estimate his, you know, alternate hypothesis, in the sense the mean will become, you know, mean will be less than 15 in alternate hypothesis.
New less than 15. Otherwise, he'll not put him in performance improvement plan at all.
Yeah.
Okay, mu less than 15 is his alternate. Now tell about null hypothesis. So I'll start with this one.
Yeah. If the engineer is solving 15 tickets or more than 15 tickets per day, manager will be happy with that. So you don't have any hypothesis to resolve those issues.
So null hypothesis will be mu greater than or equal to 15.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Now Zahir, can you tell, frame this null and alternate hypothesis for engineer?
Alternative hypothesis from engineer's perspective, on an average, mu is greater than 15.
Yes. So from his perspective, he's solving more. He want to establish that and come back into the organization instead of getting laid off. And what is alternative hypothesis? Null hypothesis?
Mu is less than or equal to 15.
Yes. That's it. So you got it, right? So based on what you want to test, that you have to keep it as null alternate hypothesis. The exact opposite of it, you keep it in null hypothesis. That's it.
Okay.
So that's what I have in this alternative and null hypothesis, how to frame the hypothesis and all. So let's see how to do the test of hypothesis. So in this case, I am going to write some steps. So these steps you will not understand at this point, but we'll do a problem, then we'll understand it very quickly. Okay, I'm going to write it as steps for test of hypothesis. Okay, so what are the steps? How do we do the test of hypothesis? Let me close this. Okay. First thing is, anyway, you have to collect the data. Then you frame the test of hypothesis. When I say frame the test of hypothesis, it means that you have to frame the alternate hypothesis and then the Or let me write that frame alternative hypothesis. The next one is frame null hypothesis. And after that, you define some alpha. Alpha, you know, right now? Alpha you have to define. Then calculate the tabulated value. In this case, I am calling this as ZTAP. I'll tell you what is the set tab, what is the tabulated value, all those things. You know these things, but because of test of hypothesis, you'll get confused. That's the only thing. Then calculate the calc value. This I am calling it as Z calc or Z calc, whatever it is. Okay, then draw the graph showing Z tab and Z calc, and finally take the decision. Okay. So you may not understand all these tabulated values, calculated values at this point, but we are going to solve it. Okay. So just to make sure, you have to first collect the data. I mean, actually, sometimes you have to frame the hypothesis and collect the data, or sometimes you collect the data and frame the hypothesis. It depends on the situation. But anyway, in any case, the first three steps will contain all these things. Either these alternative and null hypothesis will come first, or the collecting the data will come first. There will be depending on the situation. In some cases, let's say in IoT kind of applications, in IoT, most of the times you will anyway collect the data. So you already have the data, then frame the hypothesis. But in some cases where you don't have the data, in those cases, generally you'll frame the hypothesis, then based on that, you'll collect the data. Is that fine?
Yeah, Sandeep.
Yeah, then, there will be some, this step might be here also, sometimes, very rarely, but most of the times why you collect data before hypothesis is because if you already have a hypothesis to prove, you'll collect only biased data. If you collect this first, you'll collect biased data because let's say there is a Trump and Hillary election recently, you want Trump to win, let's say. Your hypothesis is already set. So what you do, you go and collect what is the evidence for Trump winning. So your data collection will be biased. That is the only reason why you don't want to frame the hypothesis before collecting the data. Okay. Now define alpha. Alpha generally, like I said, it will be mostly 5%. Calculate the tab value and calculate the calc value. When I say calc value, what is Z-calc? Z-calc is nothing but X minus mu by sigma. And Z-tab is nothing but from the table. We already looked up in the table, right? Same way we look up in the table and see what is the Z-tab. And based on that, you plot a graph. And that graph will contain, that graph will show you whether you have to reject or accept the null hypothesis. That I'll show you how. Then take the decision. This is what is the steps. So how to do this? So I already have some data set for this. So what is this data set? Coke data set. We're solving the same data set that we framed the hypothesis for. Okay, let's take any one of the view, probably customer view, because that is what we are generally most of the times. So Coke data set. By the way, this is not the real data set. This is a simulated data set. You can simulate data in R. I have simulated this data set. This is not a real data set. Okay. That is fine for our case. I'll show you how to simulate and all those things. Those are very easy topics. Okay, so first of all, what I am doing is consumer view, Coke data set. In the Coke's data set, I am doing consumer view. So what is consumer view? And this data set is actually in ML. This is in ML, this is not in ounce. This is not in ounce, okay? If you want, I can generate the data in ounce. Zahir, are you comfortable with ML or you want me to generate data set on ounce?
Anything is fine.
Anything is fine? Yeah. Because I work from India, so I tend to use ML more. You can stop me anytime. I can generate that data set as well. Okay. So what I have here is the consumer expected that the manufacturer is not delivering properly, and he framed a null hypothesis and alternative hypothesis. How did he frame the alternate hypothesis? He's saying mu is less than, so this is ML, right? So I'm keeping, in general, there will be 1000 ml in each of the Coke bottle. Okay, if it is more, generally consumer won't worry about it. But if it is less, he will worry. So on average, if mu is less than 1000 ml, that is when he'll feel bad about. That is what his pain point is actually. In general, generally pain point will go here, but sometimes it is not the case. But most of the times, you know, pain point will go here, and the reverse will go here. So in general, consumer pain point will be mu less than 1000. Okay, that's what he wanted to test. And the reverse of it is simply the null hypothesis, like I said. Okay, this is what is his hypothesis. So what are the steps? First, collect the data. We did that. Then frame the null hypothesis, alternate hypothesis, frame the null hypothesis. Those are done. Now define alpha. In this case, I define my alpha as 5%. Okay, in general, I already told, generally we'll take alpha is 5% only, most of the times, unless there is a special reason. Then calculate the tab value. Now to create the tab value, let's see what is the tabulated value. Let's draw the picture. Okay, this is your normal distribution. And generally alpha equal to 5% means, I told you this, you have to divide it into two parts, alpha by 2. And this is alpha by 2 again. Okay, so what it will become is alpha equal to, I mean, this area will be 2.5%. And this area will be 2.5%. Okay, this is what you generally want to do for alpha. Okay, so what is the tabulated value for alpha equal to 2.5%? We already saw, but let me show it again in the table. You go and 1. See.
96.
Yes, exactly. I remember that, but I just wanted to show it again. So if this is 2.5%, this will become 47.5%. And we have to look up for 0.0475 in the table. So it's going to be 1.96. This is going to be your tabulated value. Okay, this one. So for this one, 1.96. That is going to be your tabulated value. So your Z tab I am writing it as Z tab, which is from table. Z tab is nothing but tabulated value. It is going to be 1.96. But the question is, what are we testing? We are testing mu less than less than 1000. We are only testing half of the data, not entire data. So should we split it into alpha by 2, alpha by 2? No. As long as you're testing equally, mu equal to 1000, you can test two-sided. But this kind of test is going to only give you one-sided test. So that's why you should not split your one-sided test to both the sides, because you are only testing one of the side. Let's say this is mu. Either you test this side or you test this side, but you don't test both the sides. Are you getting this concept? If my test is like this, it means that I am testing only one side of the data, right? Either one side, if my mu is at the center, I am either testing for this side or this side. If I am testing for this side, alpha by 2, 2.5% I am wasting here. I should keep it here only. Why I did half-half in confidence interval is because my mu has to be centered. My confidence interval has to be centered. But in this case, my test is not centered. So are you getting this concept? Why I should not divide it into two parts in this case?
No, I did not get you, Sandeep. Can you please tell one more
time? Say, what is your confidence interval? Confidence interval, you get X bar somewhere here. What is confidence interval? You remember the formula? X bar plus or minus X bar plus sigma, Z into sigma by root M. This side. And this side, it will be X bar minus sigma, Z into sigma by root N. This will be root N. Right?
Yeah.
So we are taking equal width on both the sides. We wanted to center your data. We wanted to center the data. My X bar has to be on the center of my confidence interval. Both the sides I have to take equally. So if this is my X bar, we have to take equally both the sides, so that my X bar is at the center of my confidence interval. If I take my average of both the lower and upper intervals, I should get X bar. To do that, what I did is I removed 2.5% here, 2.5% here as the error. Did you get it? Abid, you asked a question. You have to
No, Sandeep, I did not get it properly.
What
I
did was you just mean? Thinking. See.
Yeah, why don't we divide the data? So that's what my problem.
Divide the data means how do you divide?
I mean, you are telling us to take only on one side of the normal distribution. So why don't we take two sides?
First understand confidence interval. How in confidence interval we are dividing the data? First understand one by one. Do you understand why I am equally dividing my alpha two sides? Because I have to get from here also, I have to get the same width. Here also, I have to get the same width.
Yeah.
I am centering my X bar. In my confidence interval, at my center, X bar has to be there.
In the middle. Okay.
So that's why I am dividing alpha into two parts.
Yeah.
That you got?
Yeah, I got it.
That you should get. So first think about whatever I am telling. You should not think beyond that.
Okay.
Because this is a confusing subject. If you think whatever about whatever I am telling, you will understand. If you think whatever you are thinking, then I cannot help you. Okay.
Okay.
Think about whatever I am telling. So confidence control. Sure. Why I am dividing the 2.5%? I mean, alpha by two. Did you understand?
Yeah.
Now, in this test, what am I testing?
Mu.
Mu, right?
Yeah.
And my test is less than or greater than, something like this, not equal to.
Yeah, okay.
So it means that, let's say this side. So it means that your error, all your decision making error will be only on one side of your normal distribution. The other side, yeah, you are not even testing. So how would, yeah, you get an error here?
Okay.
Okay. Okay. That's why you don't divide your data into two parts. Your entire test will be on this side only, or on this side only. When you test like,
okay,
when you test with equal to, that is a different story.
Okay.
Okay. But in this, yeah, kind of test, in this kind of test, all your errors will be only on one side. Your errors will not be on the other side because you are not testing on that side.
Okay.
Okay, let's say you have a 1 pound stone, 1 pound stone. Okay.
Okay.
This 1 pound stone, if you are testing for the hypothesis, you might think that it is less than 1 pound stone. It might be less than 1 pound.
Yeah.
Okay. Your error will be on this case only. Your error will not be on the greater than 1 pound stone because you are not going in that direction at all.
Yeah,
your test is not at all in that direction, so your error will also be not going there. Is that fine?
Yeah, I got it, Sandeep.
So your error will always be based on your test, right? Otherwise, you don't test it at all. Got it?
Yeah, I got it.
So that's, yeah.
In that case, if you're checking for mu, so in the normal distribution, we look at only one side, and even the alpha will be 5% for in this example, and one side, correct?
Yes, alpha will be 5% on one side. It will not be distributed to two sides.
Okay. So then why are we using the Z distribution? It doesn't make sense.
We still use Z distribution. Why doesn't it make sense? Because we are using the, see, all these formulas, how did we get? Because of the sampling distribution.
Yeah.
See, sampling distribution is saying, telling me, Z equal to X bar minus mu by sigma by root n. Without sampling distribution, I should assume that it is a normal distribution and then write this formula. Right?
Yeah.
So I have to assume it is normal distribution. There is no other way. But the only thing is, should I divide it into two parts or should I give it as a one part? My point is, because we are not testing both the sides, I am not getting into which side. I did not say that, okay? Till now, I have not mentioned which side. I am just saying I should not divide my alpha. That is my point. The second point is which side I should test. That I have not given as of now, okay? My only point I wanted to make it sure is that alpha, I am not going to divide because my test is either greater than or less than. So I should give it as one alpha only. I should not divide it into two pieces. If you are clear with that, I'll go with the next step. Which side I should take? Okay, are you clear with this, Zahir and Abid?
Yeah, I'm good, Sandeep.
I'm not clear, Sandeep.
You're not clear. No. What are you not clear?
The 5%, because this is what I'm thinking.
Yes, 5%. 5% you should give at one side only. Because you are not testing the other side.
But because it's a normal distribution, shouldn't you be, since it's symmetric, the sampling part should cover the other half of error, isn't it? Even though your alternate hypothesis, you're saying mu is going to be less than 1,000.
One second.
Data you're collecting.
Let me give you that. It is symmetric, but not according to what standards you are thinking about. Okay. Let's take this side this time, because last time I took that side. Okay. Let's say this is 2.5%. Okay. Now I take, let's say this additional part is going to add up to this one to make 5%. This whole thing from here plus this red part. Green part and red part, whole in a whole sum, it is going to be 5%. Now, my question is, do you think this red part and the green part are equal areas?
They're not.
They are. Probability is equal. This is 2.5%. This is 2.5%. That's what I tell. When I say 2.5%, it is the area under the curve. But the question is not that. Will the z value lie between this and this is same as this and this? No. Are you getting?
Yeah, z value is going to be different, right, Sandeep?
Because difference in z is going to be different.
Right.
This width is not equal to this width.
Correct.
So if I put the same thing, this green value here as 2.5%, this z value is not same. This will be 1.9. Let's see the table, okay? I'm getting confused. So what is 5%? If I take out 5%, I should look for 45%, which is 0.45. Right? So my z value, how much it will become? 45% is 45, 1 second. 5%, 45% is this one. Yeah. I can either take this one or this one. I am taking this one.
Yeah.
Okay. This is 1.64. Okay. This one is 1.64. How much is this one? This one is 1.96. 47.5. This is 2.5%, right? We are expecting.
Yeah.
If you divide. This is 1.96, which is negative. If you consider this as zero, it will be minus 1.96. Okay. And this one is 1.64, and this one and 1.96. How much is the difference? Very less.
Yeah, like 0.32.
How much is the difference from here to, let's say, 3 sigma or something? Because generally we don't take more than 3 sigma, right? Here to 3 sigma, it is more. Are you getting it? From 1.96 to 3 sigma, 1.96 to 3, it's going to mostly cover the entire 2.5%.
Yeah.
So that itself is more. But this 2.5%, it is only how much is the difference?
0.3.
But still, within that 0.3, it is covering the entire 2.5%. There is a difference. Some difference is there. Probability is same. Z values are different.
Yeah, of course.
The difference in Z values. So this, within this 0.3, we are covering 2.5%. Within this entire thing, we are covering 2.5%. So that's why 5% at one side is different from 2.5% at both the sides.
That's true. Yeah, that part I get it.
That part you got it, right? But I am giving another reason. What I am giving another reason is because you are not testing for the other side, take this side only.
Okay.
Because my error doesn't lie here, right? If I am testing here, how will my error lie here?
Okay.
I am giving logical answer. Now I am giving mathematical answer. That's the only thing. Okay. But logically is better answer because it is very difficult to understand this thing, this kind of concept.
Okay.
Are you convinced? Still not convinced?
It's okay. You can proceed.
It's not okay. If you are convinced, you are convinced. If you are not convinced, you are not convinced.
I understand the reasoning behind it, Sandeep.
Understand the logic. Yeah. Don't go into mathematics too much. This is my philosophy. Since you asked, I went into this mathematics, which is more complex. But if you understand the logic, because if you are testing anything greater than 1000, let's say, if you are testing for mu greater than 1000, will your error anywhere lie before this mu? This side?
Yes, your
error? Your error will not lie here. Your error will always lie here. So your error, if you are keeping your error in only one side, have your alpha only at that side. Don't have at the other side because you are not testing there. You are wasting your alpha.
Okay, okay. And I shouldn't worry about, because when you're doing, when you're collecting, getting samples out of population, right?
Mm-hmm.
There's a possibility that the error, the errors that you're getting in the sample may tend to lie both sides. That's why we initially went in sampling distribution, we went with the normal distribution. Right?
No, yeah. we went to normal distribution using sampling distribution because you don't know the original data set distribution. Why we went with sampling distribution is because you don't know the original distribution. You wanted to find out what is the, you want to do all these test of hypothesis and confidence intervals and all these things, all these inferences, but you don't know what is the distribution itself. You get some random distribution. To convert everything into one single distribution, you convert it into normal distribution. And normal distribution is supposed to be easy because it is symmetric. But just because it is symmetric, you don't have to divide every time into two alphas.
Oh, okay.
Right? Just because it is, you are doing that to, that way. That is the problem. Okay? It is symmetric. That's why it is easy. But just because it is symmetric, don't do always two alphas. That's not what I told, right? If you remember. I never told that you should always divide it into alpha two alphas. I told for confidence interval, you have to divide your alpha into two pieces. But for the other cases, there are these cases, right? Where your test of hypothesis, let's take blue. Your test of hypothesis, your testing is in this direction. How can you take alpha here? Your error is in this place only. If you are taking a decision, see, if your decision boundary, this is called decision, it's not decision boundary actually. In the if this is your area in which you are taking a decision, your decision should, your error should also lie in this area, right? How can it lie this side?
Okay, got it.
And I already showed you mathematically, right? This is this and this is not equal to this and 3 sigma.
Okay. Yeah, I got it, Sandeep. So basically, okay. Going back to your the earlier analogy,
hmm.
You are looking for someone, like for example, in the robbery case, you're looking for someone to be guilty. That's where you will tend to find the errors also.
Yes, exactly. So based on your errors only, based on your decision only, your errors will lie within your decision only.
So technically half of it, what we're testing right now is H1, when mu is less than 1000, which applies to only half the side. Okay, I got it now.
So every time I'm using symmetry, I was using, if it is minus 1.6, I converted it into 1.96. I did not convert 1.64 into 1.96, and added here.
Yeah.
Okay, there is a difference. The same probability has to be propagated from that side to this side. If you are converting 5% into 2.5%, 2.5%, it is a wrong theory.
Okay.
Okay, you have to convert this minus 0.5, 2.5% into 2.5% plus 2.5% here.
Okay.
This side has to be converted here. But you cannot add this side to this side. That I never told, if you remember.
Okay. Got it.
Okay, that you should not do. So, what I am doing is I am doing a test of hypothesis, right? So, I don't know if you are clear or not. Let me know because I am okay to explain again. Because this is going to be a tough decision. Decision making. Many people will get confused here, but if you are really clear, I can go ahead.
Yeah, I'm okay, Sandeep.
Okay. Okay. So let's see how my test of hypothesis is going to work. So I collected the data. I framed alternate hypothesis, null hypothesis. Now I defined alpha. Now I know which side, now I know my alpha has to be only one side. Now which side to do? What is my decision on? This is a little tricky, but better you remember this. Based on your, otherwise you'll get confused again. Let me draw it in black. This is your normal distribution. Now, based on your alpha and your test of hypothesis, you decided one side only. But which side to do? Which side to do generally, because your decision, final decision is on null hypothesis. Because either you say null, accept null hypothesis or reject null hypothesis. You should do based on the null hypothesis only. Okay. So your alpha, because your mu is greater than 1000, it means that your alpha has to be only on one side, and that one side has to be based on your test null hypothesis. Is that clear? It's better to remember this point. Based on the null hypothesis, you draw your alpha that side only. So if it is greater than 1000, it means that greater than is this side, right? You keep an alpha in this direction only, all your alpha here. One side you know, right? Why you have to do a one-sided test, you know. So which side to take? The side to take is always from the H naught, because your H naught is what your decision is. Final decision is on H naught. Either you reject or accept, it is on H naught only. That's why it is always on based on that symbol. If it is greater than or equal to symbol, use this side, right side. Otherwise, use a left side. This is called one-tail test. One-tail test, or in simpler term, I mean, in other terminology, we can call it as right side test or right tail test. Right tail test. Is that fine? Because what is the decision you are emitting finally? Your decision you are emitting as null hypothesis, based on the null hypothesis. So your error will also be based on the decision only. Is that fine?
Yeah, I got it, Sunny.
So this is very important. I know that you will be confused too much on this subject. Are you getting confused? Is it confusing? This is where your real subject will lie. This is going to be confusing only. Are you really getting confused, or is it fine now after my explanations and all?
I'm okay, Sandeep. So I understood why you need one. I mean, why we are going with the H naught. Mu is greater, since mu greater than or equal to 1000, you're checking and taking the right side, correct?
Yes, because finally you're emitting your decision using H naught.
Yeah.
To be frank, this is very tough topic, but I'm trying to make it as easy as possible.
Right.
If you go anywhere else in any textbook or anything, null framing hypothesis and something, test of hypothesis, you'll find it very difficult. So when you see any of these, it's going to be very, very tough actually. All these causal theory, correlation patterns, all those things, they'll confuse you even more than what is needed. So in a way, I'm trying to teach you much easier than what it is actually. Okay, but I know still it will be a little confusing. But don't worry, it will be cleared out. Okay, because this is the first time you are seeing all these things. So you know that now you can do only one tail test. And the test is on, because your decision you are making on H naught, your test is on also on the H naught. Okay. I mean, your error is also on the H naught. So if it is greater than or equal to 1000, it is greater than, right? Greater than will lie always in the right side. If H naught is less than or equal to something, then you should do a left tail test. That's how it is. So there are three types of tests. One, two-sided test. Okay. Second is one-sided right tail test. Third one is two-sided left tail test. Is that fine? Three different tests. Either you test this side or both sides. Very simple. Now, how is it going? So let's see the question again. We have these kind of data, all this data, and we want to test if my data is, we want to test with the alternate hypothesis mu less than 1000. That is my data, test. If my Coke is getting less than, if in my Coke bottle I am getting on average lesser than 1 liter, 1000 ml. Okay, how to test it? So I already gave the steps, right? Sorry. Yeah. These are done. Collect the data, alternate hypothesis, null hypothesis, alpha is defined. Now calculate the z-tab. Now z-tab is very easy. You already know it, but I did not define it as z-tab earlier. What is z-tab?
It's 1.96.
No, it's not. Now it is based on this test. This test is wrong.
1.64.
This is wrong. Yeah. 1 second. Let me remove this. This is wrong.
Okay.
Because you cannot do two-tail test.
Yeah, two-tail test.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. Only one-tail test is possible here. So to do the one-tail test, how much is the alpha? 5%. What you have to check for? 45%, which is this one. How much is it? 1.64.
1.64, yeah.
1.64. That is your z-tab. How much is z-calc? Z-calc is nothing but x bar minus mu by sigma by root n. This we already derived and did so many things about it. So it's going to be this one. Now what is x bar?
Sample mean.
Sample mean.
Yeah.
What is my sample? Sample is this one, right? I'm taking a mean of this. Average. Okay, I have to give until 46. There are 45 samples, but the first one is the label. So 46. Average sample mean is 993.52.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, Sandeep, you took initially the sample data, but not the population data, right?
I will not have population, right?
Yeah.
I will never have population. I only simulated those things. That's what I told you.
Yeah, you got it.
Okay. 993.5 whatever, 52 minus, what is mu? This is population mean, but I don't have population mean. The way to take mu is whatever is the H naught equals value. H naught will always have a equals value, I told you, right? Whatever is the equals value for H naught, which is 1000, that you have to put as the H naught, mu. Okay, don't worry about the logic. It is tough. Even I don't understand many times. But you get that, right? How to calculate it, you should know. Whatever is the equals value, you should use that as your mean. Because the logic is simple, actually. Logic is like whatever is the mu here in the test of hypothesis, because this is null hypothesis, you assume that this is going to be the mu. Anyway, don't worry about this logic. Is that fine?
Yeah, I got it, Sandeep.
H naught will always have the equals value. So that equality value that you have to use. Okay. And sigma by root n. What is sigma? Instead of sigma, I can use sample standard deviation here. Because generally I don't have the population one. And my data is more than 30. So I can use sample standard deviation. Is that fine?
Yeah, Sandeep.
This will be cleared. I mean, you'll do many times, right? So what is sample standard deviation? STDDev.S. Let me calculate everything, then you can ask any questions you may have. 45. It is 18. 18.812 by what is n? Square root of 45. N is 45. So let me calculate from here itself. X bar, let me keep brackets, X bar minus mu is 1000, I assume, by sigma, again I will create a bracket, sigma by square root of 45. Did I do correctly? X bar is this one, E2 minus 1000 by E3, which is sigma by root n. Yeah, this is correct. What is this called?
Z calc.
How much it is? 2.3. All I have to find out is Z calc and Z tab. Z tab is this one, right? Where the alpha begins. Z tab is this one. From here, alpha begins, right? This point is called Z tab. And Z tab is how much? 1.64. And Z calc is how much? 2.3?
Yeah.
So where it is falling? That is very important.
Yeah, 2.3 or minus 2.3, Sandeep?
Yeah, minus 2.3 is same as 2.3, right?
Yeah.
I can use this.
Okay.
So what I said, you cannot add up things from here to there.
Yeah,
you can just convert minus into plus. That's okay. Why I kept it here.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, this is this one. Let me keep it in red. This one. So if your Z calc is falling in, so let me define the terminology here. I am keeping this in green. This is called acceptance. I'm sorry, guys. I confused you. I'm sorry. It's 2.5. I'm really sorry. This is my mistake. Let me draw again. Okay, let me draw in black. Okay. This is mu or zero. Let's say it's zero. This is our Z tab, which is 1.64. I draw it as red. This red part is what? Alpha value. And the remaining part is all accepted region. Okay, this is the accepted region, this is the rejected region. Now my mistake is I should not have taken the minus S plus. Z tab is here and Z calc is here. So if I do it here, my accepted point will also be rejected. That's why I should not do it. That is my problem. Sorry. I really confused you. Because if I keep it here, it will come into rejected region. I should not have done that. I should not do that. This is minus. Is that fine? Why I should not do that? Even though it is sigma symmetric. This is called accepted region. This is called rejection region. So based on rejection region, based on where your point lies, either in your where your Z calc lies, whether in the rejection region or in the accepted region, based on where it falls, you have to take the decision. This is what is the point. Abid, did I confuse you? I think I cleared now, but I just wanted to ask.
Yeah.
If I keep the same point in the positive area, instead of accepting, I'll reject it.
So you shaded the region as accepted region. So what is the possible outcome? I mean, how will I decide? I mean, on which scenario do I need to decide?
Scenario is this one, test of hypothesis.
Yeah, test of hypothesis.
So when you say accept or reject, based on what you are going to accept or reject, always H0, right?
Yeah.
I already told you, always on H0, you are going to accept or reject. When my data is, when my Z calc is falling in the accepted region, what does it mean? Accept H0.
Yeah.
Anything, accept or reject, it is on H0 only.
Okay.
There is no other alternative. Always accept or reject on the H0. Okay. When okay. I say accept H0, it means that what is it? What is his hypothesis?
Mu greater than or equal to 1000.
He started with mu less than 1000, but actually mu greater than or equal to 1000. There is an interesting thing. That's why I took this example. Okay. What is he saying? Mu, what is the final outcome? Mu greater than or equal to
1000.
So which means consumer lost his case in court.
Yeah, now we got it, Sandeep.
Okay. Now, the important point here, what I wanted to describe here is this one. Sorry. What I wanted to describe here is what is the average? It's coming less than 1000.
Yeah.
But what is my answer?
1000.
Actually, my sample, whatever I collected, it is saying less than 1000. Okay.
Yeah.
But my final answer, my final mu is my population mean, right? My population mean is greater than 1000. My sample mean is less than 1000, but my population mean is greater than 1000. How does it happen? It happens because your sample, see, even though your sample is saying something, your inference, population inference, is going to actually work on the real population mean. It's not going to work on the sample means, X bars. So even though your sample is saying my mean is not that much, based on your inferential statistics only, you have to decide. Don't decide based on your X bars. Don't decide on your sample means, is what I wanted to tell. Never decide based on, see, the consumer, what he might have done. He might have collected 45 bottles and then took an average, and that average is not coming more than 1,000. He might have directly said, okay, I'm not getting this much. But final decision, whenever you're taking, your decision should never be on your sample. Your decision should be on the population. In this case, the population is mu. I should take my decision on this mu, not on the X bar. Only if I do this test of hypothesis, I can find out if my real mu is proper or not. So in this case, what this customer did is, he took only 45 samples. He did the test of hypothesis, and finally he lost the case. Just because he worked on the sample means. Don't collect the sample and finally analyze the sample. Your sample is only representative of the population. Do a test of hypothesis. Only then decide what to do. Is that fine, Zahir and Abid?
Yeah, I got it, Sandeep. So suppose, for example, if I assume if the consumer have population mean, so what will happen then?
Can you tell me again? I could not hear properly.
Yeah, if I assume consumer have population mean, so what will happen then?
Consumer has proper population mean. He'll never have, right? Will he have?
Yeah, in real scenario, he will never have. But if I assume.
So you take any scenario.
Okay.
Any scenario in the world. In general, any real world scenario. Let's say you're a student and your marks are some 50 out of 100. Okay. Yeah. Will you know for that particular, let's say that class is machine learning. Okay. That course is on machine learning. And you got only 50% of the marks. And you want to know, out of all the people who took this course, how much is the average? Am I falling? So is my average greater than is my population average greater than 50 or not? I mean, whatever I'm saying is does all the people who take machine learning as their course have greater than my marks or not, my percentage or not? If you want to do that, will you know all the students who took all the machine learning courses? And
no, I cannot.
You can never get. So in any case, it's not even most of the cases, it's all of the cases. Okay. At least 99.99% of the cases, you'll never know the population mean.
Yeah, no, you got it, Sandeep.
Okay. That's why, so he'll never know. So if he knows, then there is no test of hypothesis. Why should you do the test of hypothesis? Test of hypothesis and inferential statistics, all these things you are doing because you only have the sample and you don't have the population. If you already have the population, there is no test. What should you do the test on? Yeah.
Still trying to wrap my head around. So you said -2.31 is Zcalc.
Mm-hmm.
Z.64.
Yes.
So from there, I understand the latter part. I understood when mu's, you're working around the population mean as opposed to the sample mean.
Mm.
So based on that, the consumer lost his case.
Mm.
Right? But the middle part where you're saying the accepted region,
your alpha is always going to be the error case.
Right.
Anything other than that is accepted case.
Right.
That's what I'm saying. So this entire thing is going to be accepted region because you are not going to see your only error in your decision is going to be here.
Yeah.
Okay. That's why this is actually rejection region. Your null hypothesis, you have to reject only when it is below this alpha region. Anything else, it's going to be the accepted region.
So the negative 2.31, how does it how is it significant? I think that's my question.
What is significance? Let me ask you this question.
So you're saying it's lying the negative region, right? So the entire portion up to minus 2.31 is an accepted region, correct?
Hmm.
Up to the alpha where it is 1.64.
See, this is where your, from here, this is where your rejection region comes in. So what is your problem? Is it is your problem on accepted region and rejected region, or what is the question actually?
The question is,
I guess he is asking about what is the use of G calculated value.
Z calculated value and Z tab, I understood, because it signifies your rejection region. That's where the cutoff is.
This is your cutoff region. This is where your actual actual sample is lying. This is calculated from the sample, right?
Yeah.
This is what signifies your sample. This is what signifies your decision boundary, after which everything is rejected.
Okay.
So where are you falling? Is your sample falling in the before the rejection region or after the rejection region? So to signify that, I calculated this Z calc.
So you're saying this particular sample we're dealing with did not have any errors, correct?
It will have errors. But what I'm saying is with 5% chance, I am accepting H naught. Is that fine? My alpha is always there. Every decision is risky in statistics. Whether I accept, even there is a lot of difference here, even then, I would say always there is a 5% chance there is a mistake in my decision. But still, I accept with 5% chance of wrong decision, making a wrong decision, I accept my H naught. Still confused?
Yes. Yeah, I understood the your reasoning. Right? So from minus 2.31, that's where your sample Z calc is lying, and the sample minus 2.31 is lying in the accepted region, which is also fine. And the rejection part also I understood. And when you're coming to consumer losses case, I understood that part also, but I'm trying to tie the sequence of events. Maybe I'm not able to tie.
Okay, then if you understood everything but you're not able to connect, then you have to think about it more and more. But you understood the reasoning everywhere, right? That's what is more important actually.
Okay.
Test of hypothesis is going to be tough. I tried to make it easy, but still, you know, there will be definitely some cases where you don't understand. But think about it more. Do some problems in Levin and Rubin. Did you buy the Levin and Rubin?
Yeah, today I got the other one.
Yeah, solve the problems. Don't read the material because it's very big and it will be only theoretical. You'll not get the actual reasonings one unless you do the problems.
Okay.
Let's see. Let's do one thing. Shall we take a class tomorrow? Evening. Evening, my time is morning. Your time probably. Saturday morning.
Yeah, Saturday morning is fine.
At what time is it fine for you?
Saturday morning for us or for you?
Saturday morning for you.
Saturday morning for me. Yeah, it's fine, Sandeep.
Saturday morning is, what is it?
It's Saturday morning in the sense it will be night time for you.
Night of Friday?
No, no, I mean evening time for you.
Saturday for Saturday evening for me, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, tell me the time which is appropriate for you.
You can decide, Zahir.
Maybe 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock.
Whatever. 8 o'clock might be too late for me, right? I think it is 10 o'clock for me. Is it right?
No, Sandeep, it will be earlier, right? It will be 5:30.
It will be 5:30, yeah? Okay. 8 o'clock in the evening. Is that fine then?
Yeah.
We'll take one and a half hour, if possible, 2 hours also. So block 2 hours so that it will be easy.
Sandeep, if it is 8 o'clock, that means it's 11:30 in the morning.
Sorry?
You're saying 8 o'clock night for you?
For you. I'm talking about you only.
8 o'clock in the morning.
8 o'clock in the morning for you.
Okay. Yeah, that's fine.
That is fine, man. You're in CST or?
EST.
EST. Hmm. EST to IST is what we want. I'm very bad in this time calculations. I always say wrong. So when is the EST tomorrow, right? On Friday, Saturday. Saturday we want.
So 8 a.m. 5:30 p.m.
8 a.m. 5:30.
Yeah.
5:30 to 7:30.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's do some problems and find out how just of hypothesis is working. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay then. Yeah. I'm closing the session today.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you,
sir. Okay.
Bye. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Bye.